are the things that you can use to kind of take your training and racing to the next level. And the first one is having appropriate expectations by your runner type. How many of you have seen that article or the videos or anything related to speedster, combo runner, or endurance monster? So I've talked about that for years, this idea that runners seem to fall into different categories. They seem to have tendencies toward one type of runner or the other. Now, most of us are pretty good across the board, but how many of you feel like you're actually a little bit more speed oriented? You like those short, fast workouts. You seem to perform better in shorter races like 5Ks and 10Ks as opposed to half marathon or marathons. Who feels like they're a little bit more speedster oriented? Some of you feel more speedster. Now, what about the other end of the spectrum? These are athletes that they really like the long runs cannot be long enough. They love the long distance training, the longer races. The thought of going to the track and doing speed work or racing short races really makes their hamstrings start twitching. Who's more sort of endurance oriented? How many people feel like you're a little bit more endurance oriented? That's really interesting. That was something that I learned pretty early on in my coaching. I started to notice, even though I'd have a group of runners who were kind of equally matched performance-wise, when we would do the training, there would be some workouts, one of the athletes would be in front, and another workout, they would always, it would flip, and the other athlete would be in front. This picture's of me on the right and my buddy Caleb on the left. We had just done rim-to-rim in the Grand Canyon, and we trained together a lot when I lived in Flagstaff. And we were a perfect example of what I just talked about. So he's much more of the endurance monster type. So longer the better, tempo runs, steady state runs, half marathon, marathon training and racing. That really suited his particular running type. I'm the opposite. I'm much better at the shorter, faster stuff. I love going to the track. I love racing the mile or the 5K. The marathon, even though I've won a national championship at that distance, it doesn't come naturally to me. It's just one of those things I feel like my body's almost fighting against me when I'm training for the marathon. So when we would train together, I really had to utilize this lesson, because if we were to do a tempo run or a steady state run or any sort of long continuous work, which was really the sweet spot for him, but it was really not the strength for me, what I had to do was I had to know if I can stay with him or even just slightly behind him, that's a successful day for me. Now, if I didn't know this about my runner type, I would be upset if he was in front of me, right? I would think, oh, I'm having a poor workout because I can't run with Caleb, even though when we race almost the same level. But because I know he's an endurance monster, I'm more speedster oriented. If I'm behind him, that's probably appropriate for that type of workout. Now, as you might imagine, when the roles are reversed and we would go to do something short and fast, I'm typically in front of him and he's a little bit behind me because, again, I'm doing a workout that really suits my physiology and psychology. So that's really instructive for you as a runner, isn't it? Because you have to adjust your expectations based on your runner type. So if you go into a workout that is of your type, it's your strength. So for me, that would be, oh, I'm going to go to the track and do 400 meter repeats, which I said yesterday was one of my favorite type of workouts. Then I can have an expectation that I'm probably going to run at the middle to the fast end of the pace range for those repeats, because that's a workout that I expect to excel in. Now, when I go to do a tempo run or a steady state run, that type of work is the opposite for me. It's not a strength, it's a weakness for me. So there I'm looking at the low end of the pace range and maybe I'll get to the middle of the pace range. That's a successful day for me. Can you see how just that little adjustment in expectation can make a big difference in how you feel about your training? And this is something I really have to teach when I work in groups of runners, particularly new runners that are getting started. You have two people that join the training group together, right? And then all of a sudden, one starts to perform better than the other in certain workouts, the other, and they get confused. Why is she performing better? We're the same. We started at the same time. And I have to teach them, hey, this comes down to your uniqueness as a runner. It seems to be related to your muscle fiber types. We have slow twitch and fast twitch. Those that have a lot more slow twitch, a little bit of fast twitch, those are more of our endurance monsters. The reverse, those of us that have a little bit more fast twitch, then we're a little bit more of the speedster. It comes down to your energy systems and sort of what you inherited principally from your mother, your ability to process energy through your aerobic systems. Those that have really great aerobic systems, they tend to be more the endurance monsters. Speedsters, not so much. So there's these sort of individual sort of genetic traits that set your path as to what type of runner you are. And then the psychology as well. What do you like? What do you enjoy? Most of the times those match up, but those all play a role in your kind of runner type and what your strengths and weaknesses may be as a runner. It doesn't mean you shouldn't do things that are not your strength. Right? When I was training for that national championship in the marathon, obviously I had to do a lot of tempo runs, a lot of long runs, a lot of fast finish long runs, goal pace runs. I had to do all of those things. I just knew that those would be a big challenge for me. I had to temper my expectations for those workouts. The workouts where they were fitting my strength, I knew 100% I should be able to perform really well in that workout. This is another way that you can take your training to the next level is as you look across your training plan, start to circle those workouts that you feel like are going to match your strength. Those are the ones you should have a high expectation. I should be able to really nail this workout. And this is the important one. For those workouts that you circle and you say, hey, this is a weakness for me, then you need to lower your expectations. You shouldn't have the same level of expectation for a workout that's your strength that it is for your weakness. That makes sense, right? It makes logical sense. But as athletes, we're crazy because we get into workouts. We always want to run the fast end of the pace range, or we always want to run with our training partner, even though they may be a different type. So I find that adjusting this expectation is a wonderful way to smooth out your training. So you're always kind of mentally having the appropriate sort of mental state. And that allows you to build that confidence. Because if you go into a workout that's not your strength, but you have an expectation that you're really going to knock it out of the park, you can see how that could really hurt your confidence. It could hurt your motivation. So as a coach, that's why I'm always teasing out, this is the expectation for this workout for this athlete. Let's make sure we have an appropriate expectation. Mark mentioned yesterday my book, You Only Faster, and the whole book is about this idea, as he talked about, he actually summarized it really well. It's like, take a training plan and then tear it apart to figure out how it works for you. And I don't know how clearly this will be on your screen, but this is a half marathon plan that I've sort of marked up for myself, and I'm a combo speedster runner. So again, I'm much better at the short stuff. So I put STs for strength on all of these workouts that I felt like would be a strength for me. And then this is WK, so weakness, on all of these workouts that I felt would be difficult for me. They don't suit my strength. So as you'd imagine, fast finish long run, tempo run, fast finish long run, this is steady state run. So any of those long continuous, that doesn't suit me. Now for Caleb, it would be the exact opposite, right? He would have all of these as strengths that would work for him. And the point of doing this is, again, you can adjust your expectation for all of these workouts. So I have to do these types of workouts to get ready for a half marathon, but I just circle them so I know, temper my expectations. Really, I'm just thinking, can I get through this workout? Can I get to the minimum pace range for the minimum amount of time? That's a successful workout for me. But if it's a strength, then I'm expecting I'm going to do the maximum at probably the faster end of the pace range. Completely makes sense, right? If you do this ahead of time, so you're not kind of too subjective or emotional when you're actually in that training week, but you're looking ahead in your training, right? And you're going ahead and adjusting your expectations, that's a really great way to approach your training. And I have these two circled because I have two weakness workouts in a row, right? And so that is a real red flag for me. I know this is going to be a very, very challenging week for me mentally and physically, right? So you have to think about your brain when you're training as well. So for this particular week, if I were to do it as it's listed, I know this day, day four, which would probably be Thursday for me, would be a big challenge. And then I've got another big challenge 2 days later. So I actually might change this week. I might flip-flop or swap these two workouts. So I'd move this tempo run to the week before, tempo intervals, which is a strength, to this week, right? So now I don't have two weakness workouts in the same week. That's an easy way for you to modify your training so that it fits you better and you don't have two weakness workouts in the same week. Again, because I've got to protect my brain. I got to make sure I'm feeling confident, particularly as I get just 2 or 3 or 4 weeks from the race. I want to make sure I'm doing that. Here's another example in week 11. Now, this is just the week before the race. Two weakness workouts are scheduled. I probably would never do that just because I know I'm fragile mentally. So even though that steady state run and a fast finish long run are perfect for getting ready for the half marathon, for a speedster type like me, it's not. So I would put in a workout that's a strength. Probably still do this fast finish long run because it is so race specific, but I'm not stacking two weakness workouts. And that's why in my training plans, like in Run Team, you see all the training plans. You'll see there's a combo version, there's a speedster version, and there's endurance monster version, because I've already done this type of work within those plans. I've already tried to pre-adjust them for athletes once they self-identify they're more speedster or endurance monster, so that they don't run into these situations where they have two really challenging workouts mentally. They also may take longer to recover from these workouts that are not their sort of strength. So I've tried to adjust those already. But I think this lesson is really key for you taking your running to the next level, is start to realize, okay, am I more speedster oriented or am I more endurance? You can always put all of your personal best in the McMillan running calculator and you can see what the predictions are. Like when I do that, I see my mile and my 5K are far superior. They're far faster relative to my half marathon and marathon. So I'm just more speed oriented. Some other people are exactly the opposite. That's another clue as to what type of runner you are. Once you understand that about yourself, it really opens up training, doesn't it? It allows you to go into each workout mentally prepared with the proper expectation. Everybody find that good? Does that make sense? Alex, you have a question?
I wanted to comment because this is so important and so it's very profound. And it amazes me that it took me so long to figure this out. I'm pretty good at looking at data, but I had ignored some of the clues and I didn't have all the clues because I had never done a lot of fast work. I'd never been to the track, didn't do those workouts, I had raced 5K to marathon and was mediocre at everything. But if I look at those times, I was definitely better on the shorter times. And it was only this year. So I've been running for 10 to 12 years with a big break in the middle. And just now I realized that I'm actually a speedster. And there were a couple of confounding things. And you mentioned the aerobic capacity. Mm-hmm. I have a very good aerobic capacity, so that's one of the things that tricked me into thinking I was better at endurance. And I have the mental strength. I can keep going, and I enjoy that challenge, and I can push myself to continue even though I'm slow and in pain.
Yeah.
So I thought that that's what I was good at because I had never done the speed work. And then so finally looking at the data and realizing, oh, wow, my mile predicts way faster on all those other distances. And I had struggled, worse at the 10K and then not so great, okay at the half marathon and then the marathon. I knew I could do better. Anyway, when I put all that together, so really encouraging younger people, or when you're sooner rather than later, figure that out. And sometimes you got to take a step back from it to get a better perspective.
No doubt about it. And that's why I tell athletes, okay, the first plan, choose a combo. So we've got a lot of variety, and then pay attention as you're doing the training and start, you know, after the training, go back and make those notes. This was a strength workout. This was a weakness workout. All of that is, again, it's an exploration for you. You're trying to figure yourself out. And so go through the combo, and then the next time we know, okay, maybe we should try a speedster. And then sometimes, even if you're a speedster, it's fun to try an endurance plan and just challenge yourself and say, okay, for this cycle, I'm really going to work on my weaknesses. I'm going to put myself in a situation where I know, okay, these workouts are going to be challenging, but you have adjusted your expectation. That's the main thing, is you're adjusting your expectation for those workouts. This has been a real key for getting so many stellar results through the training system. I think it's less about the exact X's and O's, and it's more about how we arrange those X's and O's and how the athlete actually is doing the training. So I was really excited to write that book because I felt like that hadn't been talked about enough. I felt like we'd always talked about the X's and O's and these are the workouts you have to do. But it was like, yeah, but when everybody does the same training plan, different people respond differently across that plan. And it really is that teasing out of, you know, whether you are like me or you're like Caleb. And as a result, you can adjust that. Even with the pro runners, I completely screwed up one of the athletes because I thought he was an endurance monster. I trained him like that for the full year. He improved only moderately at his 10K. We sat down at the end of the year. We kind of did a review looking back at the training. And I said, Jordan, I think I screwed up. I think you're kind of like Alex. I think you're more of a speedster than you are endurance monster, but you sure looked like it when we first talked. It sure seemed like you were that way. So the next year, same training process, but I adjusted his training to be more speedster. I sprinkled in more of the speed, more of the sprint workouts. For any of the long stuff that we again had to do, I would break it up. So instead of a continuous steady state like his endurance monster training partners were doing, I would break it up. So we'd do steady state intervals. He'd do 10 minutes at steady state, take a minute recovery, 10 minutes again. So we just modified things. He improved his 5K from 14 minutes and 1 second, which is already really fast, to 13 minutes and 31 seconds. A 30-second improvement for that speed, that's massive. For most of us, that's like taking 3 minutes off of our 5K time. It's like a huge improvement. Same coach, same training idea, but just tweaked for his type. Big improvement. So again, that was reinforcing to me that is, as an athlete, if you can kind of dial this in, it makes a big, big difference. So again, as you're looking ahead, start to circle those workouts, start to think this is a strength, this is a weakness, and adjust your expectations. Sound like a plan?
Yep. Hey, Greg, I just have a comment. Yep. I think I got your book when it first came out too. And I've got to say that your book has been the first one I've ever seen, and I've read a lot of them, where it gave you the license, almost demanded that you had to do this, that if you just tried to follow anybody's running plan, no matter who it was, it wasn't going to work, that you had to keep tweaking and everything. My book right now is almost falling apart because I've gone back to it so many times. And the only thing, if you ever put out a second edition, put an index in it, because I've had to create my own index. I've got sticky markers all over the place with it.
And oh, that's great.
Again, I don't think there's anything out there that really has encouraged people to do that.
Yeah, I feel like it's important. We talked about it a little bit yesterday, right? It's empowerment. You've got to be empowered. The training plan can't be stamped on you. You know, the plan has to fit you, not the other way around. And that's why I'm really encouraging athletes. Ultimately, you have to be your own coach. Now, I don't want to put myself out of business, but I think you understand what I mean. I mean, when you're doing the training, you've got to be making some of these decisions because you're the one who feels it and is specific to you. So I really appreciate that comment. I hope all of you will now going forward start to have that change. It makes a big difference, particularly if you are sort of mentally fragile with tough workouts, like you beat yourself up, you dwell on those hard workouts, this adjustment of expectation really helped me. Otherwise, I would have been super upset because Caleb was in front of me in tempo runs. I'd felt like I was failing. But actually, I knew, well, if he's 5 seconds in front of me, that's actually a really good workout for me. That adjustment in expectation was really good. So high five, fist bump, for we're going to do that going forward as well.